All right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll call this October meeting of the Valdosta Valens County Zoning Board of Appeals to order. Everyone in attendance, please make sure that you sign in on the attendance sheet at the back of the meeting room. Before we begin, I will explain the process for the meeting. I will call each case on a case-by-case name and number. The city or county representing staff will come to the lectern and present the facts of the case. After presentation, the board may or may not ask questions of the staff. Once the board has heard the case and asked all questions necessary of staff, we will move to hearing from either the applicant or the applicant's representation. After hearing from the applicant, we will hear from anyone else who wishes to express support for the case. Finally, we will hear from anyone who wishes to express opposition to the case. Anyone addressing the board will please come to the lectern and give their name and address for the record. For clarity and respect, we ask that only the person at the lectern address the board and that the audience give them an uninterrupted chance to be heard. If there is important information that you feel we need to consider, then please come to the lectern when it is your turn and you are called. In the interest of time, though, the board asks that you keep your comments brief and to the point. Please do not come to the lectern only to restate the same information that we have already been given by someone else. Once the board has had the chance to hear from all sides on the matter and ask any questions we feel are necessary, then we will render a decision. If we do not feel that the necessary information is available to render a decision today, then we may decide to table the case for the next meeting. Please be aware that this board is here today only to address variance applications to the zoning codes for Valens County and the City of Valdosta. This is the only matter on which this board has been given the power to render decisions. We cannot and do not have the power to address any other matters that are not covered by the zoning codes of Valens County or the City of Valdosta. Now, we will begin with the first case, VAR 2019-11. Village Pope, Old Clydeville Road. Ms. Deborah.
Thank you, Chairman. Mm-hmm.
Chairman. Once again, for the record, this is application VAR 2019-11. This is a project of this application was issued by the South Georgia House of Hope on a project that they're working on for its next expansion, which will remain the Village of Hope. In this case, the applicants are asking to utilize an existing 30-foot wide ingress-egress easement off of Old Clydeville Road. Previously, the applicants were able to get to their property off of an easement on Indian Ford Road. There's language that I've written in my staff report, and I'm talking with the actual business owner here today. There, you may hear some discrepancies in regards to the agreement between her and the property owner of the easement on Indian Ford Road. But initially, I was under the impression that the property owner and the current owner of the easement were in agreement that should the county bring water out to this area, that the existing ingress-egress access would be used for the county to allow the county to put in water utilities through that easement, which meant that the owners and the applicants of the residents would have to find another way as far as assessing the property. And this is their other means of doing so. This 30-foot ingress-egress access is also used by another business, the Alaska Lake Compound. And this property is owned by the Wagners, the same landowners of Village of Hope and House.
Any questions of staff?
So they're proposing that they're going to use the same driveway that the Wake Compound uses?
Yes, ma'am.
Is that a county maintained road or is that a private road?
It's private. It's just private. 30-foot easement.
Okay, go back to the other easement that's on Indian Ford Road. Or are they wanting to still use that also?
I don't have clarity on that, Ms. Nancy, but I can assure you someone here in this room will probably speak further to that. After speaking with the owner just a few minutes ago.
Which owner?
The owner? Ms. Sharon Wayne, okay. Landowner, business owner. And I was advised that she had not made the agreement with the neighbor.
To give up the other access.
Right. But I believe that they have conversated something here just a matter of minutes ago that will be
Do you have to have that easement on Indian Ford Road as well as this 30-foot one to access the property?
No, you do not.
Is the property, the subject property, is currently accessed off of Indian Ford Road, is that right?
Yes, sir.
And then the current location of House of Hope is also currently accessed off of Indian Ford Road, is that right?
It's one and the same.
What is this little building here labeled House of Hope?
I'm already not existing, sure what it is.
Sir. Already existing building?
I'm sorry. Yes, this is already existing. Yes, sir.
And that's also accessed off of Indian Ford Road?
Yes, yes. Everything, that entire lot, that entire 10-acre lot, sir, is currently accessed off of Indian Ford Road. And if I may, the ZBA back in September of 2010, I believe is the correct date, approved for several variances, and one of the variances was for that access off of Indian Ford Road. And that was for a tagging track. And so what the applicant wants to do now, they want to expand. And in doing so, they want to make this trade with the neighbor for the Indian Ford easement, and then they will find another point of ingress, egress, and that's that existing 30-foot right now.
So let me make this clear. They're going to give up the original easement in lieu of having the 20-foot one in Oak Lawn.
Very good question. I do not have the answer. I believe her attorney will respond to that.
Any more questions of staff? Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Would the applicant or the applicant's representation like to address?
Good afternoon. Bill Madden on behalf of 78 Patterson Street. Here on behalf of the House of Hope. I think I can ask clarity of this. All this came together at the last minute, really. Not that we'll end last minute, too, because my partner's not here. So, there are two easements to access the property now. There's the one off Old Clyde Road, and there's one off Indian Ford. The applicant is willing, and what they'd like to do, and what they've been trying to do now, a little bit in the future, is use the easement off Old Clyde Road as a primary access. Okay? So, for this new development, they will try and use that easement and reuse that easement as their primary access for the house and over for this new development. What we have discussed with Mr. Sims, because the house and over does eventually, when the county runs water and sewer down in the Ford Road, we need to be able to tie into that water and sewer. The most direct way to do that is across the easement area, across Mr. Sims' property, to go out to Indian Ford Road, that access easement. Now, that is a legal access easement. As far as I'm aware, it's a platted legal access easement, okay? I don't think the applicant is saying they're going to give up their rights to do that, so to use that easement. They don't want to give up their legal rights to use that easement. But what they will say, again, they'll use the easement after the platted road as their primary access. Mr. Sims is going to put up a gate along the easement that goes out to Indian Ford Road and provide the House of Hope a key to that gate so they can still use that easement to get to the House of Hope. However, it will be gated. You know, certain people sharing the record will have access through that gate. Okay, so we're going to limit the access along that easement out to the other agent right up and you know the thought is if you change we'll have the ability to tie in to more direct route to water and sewer across Mr. Sims' property eventually going to count these water surround that. I think that's a 12-18 month window that we'll be at.
So to tie in into water, they're going to have to go across somebody else's property, not just the easement.
Well, they will go across somebody else's property through the easement. Through the easement, because they're going to have access to it. Now, it's my understanding that, I call them complicated things this much further, but they can go ahead and build, I think, four houses out there, along with the meeting hall, and I believe they're going to run the water park behind that, that's by the water and sewer. And so the county is going to let them go and tie into that to build the initial four houses and the new house. And so it's when they build the next four that they're going to have to get access to the water and sewer.
Which the county thinks they will have in 12 to 18, 24 months?
Pleasure.
Somewhere along the way, I can't give you that.
Oh, come on.
Please.
Okay. The easement that we're talking about that we're going to have gated. Should there be some other natural problem, whatever, that's preventing access through the old Fayetteville Road, who else is going to have potentially a key in case emergency vehicles need to come down the easement and no?
I think we have to work that out with town and Mr. Sounds. I mean, I think emergency vehicles, it's always been contemplated that if emergency vehicles need to get back there using that easement across Mr. Sounds' property, they will have access to do that. So, I mean, I would think if it's locked, it's key, some of the county's going to have key to that, or the fire department, police department. I don't know how y'all handle that. It would be for emergency vehicles as well. Thank you.
Who maintains these driveways? And how are they maintained?
Yeah, that is a good question. And the easement going out to Indianford Road, I'm not sure who maintains that. They do. The other reason is because I don't apply, I'm pretty sure Hospital does, and Wake Park.
Because the county is currently running into this problem of private roads, if you will, things that look like roads but are just easements. And then they become into disrepair, and the people who are using them become in dire circumstance, especially when it rains. Now, it didn't rain here in a really long time, but it will rain here again. And we have a big community living back there. I'm seriously concerned about how that road is going to be maintained and how emergency vehicles are going to get back there in horrible weather. Down won't be done before.
Okay, I'd be happy to dedicate it to the county.
The county wants it. We actually want to see that. We really want to. We want to let it bring the water through there as well.
I mean,
well, when you build a road to the county standard, then you can do that.
Yeah, I understand the concern. And I would say that that's their primary means of ingress and egress, and so it's an happiness.
$8,000
I wasn't aware of that. There's crushed concrete all the way up and down. This is the easement built by. So they improved it already with crushed concrete. I'll be less likely to wash out.
Bill, what is Village of Hope, and what is going to be the use of this property, and what's the anticipated traffic count coming along?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. I was going to let Ms. Wagner go up and talk to you a little bit about why they wanted to do this and what it's all about. From what I understand, these are houses for families to transition to. They're living in a house that now, women that have families. So they can come. There's really limited space that's there now. But a lot of these women that are living there do have families and children. And I think these are houses that they can transition to with their children and families and stay there. But Sharon can talk to you more about that. How many people we anticipate. I mean, I know there's 8 houses. So I would assume that there's 1 family, maybe they have the most in each house. Any other questions?
Anybody else on behalf of the owner?
My name is Sharon Reiner. I'm the director at South Georgia House of Hope. And I just would like to address you, Nathan, the question about what is the House of Hope. We've been here in Valdosta for 14 years at that location. And we serve women who are overcoming alcoholism, addiction, and abuse. It's a nonprofit organization. A lot of the ladies that come to us have exhausted all the resources, have tried secular programs, they've been through other rehabilitation programs and not been successful. And so they come to the House of Hope kind of as a last hope, where they are willing to give 1 year of their life to allow the Lord to go deep into their heart and change them. They're really desperate to want to change. Change and have been successful. And so most of the women that we get are to that point. For somebody to say, I'll take a year of my life and just go to a place and learn what's wrong, what are the roots of my problems, and how can I be a different person and not struggle with
abusive relationships or alcohol or drugs. So we've been serving single women for the last 14 years, and what we found is that many of the women who come to us have to leave their children behind. And so the children end up in foster care or with another family member or with a friend, and the children need healing too. And it's also very hard for mom to make a choice, do I give help or do I stay here with my children? Have to leave their children behind. So, and then we also have many women call us who are pregnant and who are wanting to stop using drugs and alcohol so they can deliver a healthy baby and become a healthy mom. And so we found that the need is so great that the Lord is calling us now to enlarge and begin to take pregnant women and mothers and children to serve the whole family, and also foster children who've been taken out of the system and then out of home and put into the system because of substance abuse of their parents. So our heart is to see these families restored, these women's lives changed, and these children to grow up in a home where they don't have to live with alcohol or drugs or abuse, and change that generational pattern for them, give them hope and a new life. And one of our young ladies is here today that just had a baby, and so she's actually in the home. You know, and so we need to expand and make room for houses for the mothers and children to be able to live in a safe community where they have support and have accountability. And so that's the reason why we're expanding. So we would have one room, but we would move out of the house that we're in now. We're in one. It's an older farmhouse. It's beautiful, but all the ladies are upstairs in one room. And we can house 11 women right now. And so what our goal is in the village is to build a large house with one wing for the single women, one wing for the pregnant women, and then 8 cottages for mothers with children. And it would all be in one community, and then 4 foster care homes that where the children could be in a home environment, but they could have supervised visitation with their mom while she's going through the program. So the kids wouldn't have to be sent across the state line, which is what's happening in Japan. Such an overload on the foster care system. So it causes even more trauma for the children in the long term to get help. So that's our heart, and that's what we do, and that's what God's called us to. And there's a huge need in this community and in the state of Georgia. So we're working with DFACS and Habitat, is working with us, partnering with us to help us to build these cottages. Individuals and churches in the community as well are sponsoring. We have an 87% success rate of ladies that complete our program are still drug and alcohol free after 5 years. So it's an excellent record. It's great to see their lives get changed. So that's what we do.
How many people do you think will be living
anticipated
in the village?
When we build a large home, we won't be able to build until the county water comes in, because that home will have to be sprinkled. So that big house will have 10 women on one side maximum, 10 women on one side and a maximum of probably 6 pregnant girls, because that takes a little bit more attention when you have a baby and they're going through maternity issues and all. So that's 16 if we were full and max. And then the 8 cottages would have a mom and children living in that. So that would be 8 more with children. So you're talking probably about 30 people. And then the foster care homes would start with 2, 1 for girls, 1 for boys, and they would house 4 children in each house with house parents. That's future. You know, our goal is to do the cottages first. The county's agreed to let us start with 4. And then once the county water comes in and we're able to build the other 4 cottages in the large house, then that would be phase 2, and then foster care would be phase 3.
In terms of a percentage of the overall cost, these are not inexpensive dwellings that you're building. How much would it cost to make this road be to the county standard? How long is it? How long?
It's 2 miles.
You're driving 2 miles to Dallas.
It's 2 miles back there.
So fire trucks are going to go. You put 2 miles worth of gravel down.
Is that right, Matt? Is it 2 miles? 1 mile and a quarter from old Clyde. Yeah, from old Clyde to
put down vinyl wrap on that?
We did, Rob, yes.
The whole way?
I don't know if it's the whole way, but I know they put $8,000 for the wrap.
Okay, so, back to my question, this is my question though. To bring this road to, I'm really not comfortable with the emergency vehicle access. We see problems all around the county. To bring, what would the cost factor be to bring this to something closer to a county road?
I don't know, but we would still be able to access the other way of emergency vehicles. Actually, when we spoke with the First Step meeting, the fire department said that if any gates are put out there, they need to be fire department accessible. So I don't know what that means, if they have a code, or if they have a button, or what, but so could the fire trucks. And they said it would have to be that way on both sides of the property, the east and west.
Right, well, I'm talking about the Clydeville access.
So.
Because that's gonna be your primary access.
Right.
That's where, when you say, I'm at so-and-so Clydeville Road, that's where the fire trucks are coming.
Yeah, our address is actually in Indian Ford Road, 2551 Indian Ford Road, is our address. That's our physical address. But we're obtaining the 20 acres next to us on the east side, which will come right up to that other easement. So now we're bordering on that easement and the easement on the other side, so we have an easement on both sides of the property. So right now we have access both ways, but we're trying to primarily use the whole Clydeville, that easement, just out of consideration on the road. Because he lives, his house is right by, I mean, 5 feet from the easement.
It's only a one more.
Yeah, it's a little tiny one-lane road.
Right.
Yeah, but the other road is 30 foot. Our easement is 30 foot too, but it's not 30 foot. It's supposed to be, it's not. But the other road is 30 foot.
And do you have an imagination that more houses would be out here beyond the big house in eight?
No.
Because one House of Hope was out there, you know.
14 years ago.
Yeah, so now we have a bigger, now we're making a bigger thing. So I'm just thinking, when we make a variance like this, it's forever. And it's for whatever the use of the property is, forever. So if you go away, and you're not doing this thing out there, the easement, the variance that we make exists forever. So.
I'm not going to vary that one. Because this is the call about life, when we told him to take children, I sat in the door. Because I have a lot which is for me. I said, the children, not really children? You know, so it's my.
It's about the land though.
Yes.
I mean, every piece of land that we look at, it's about the specific piece of land.
But the land is zoned for that purpose. It is zoned commercial, we pay commercial taxes on that whole piece.
Right, and if you built a little strip plaza out there, you'd have to have a road that was appropriate to accommodate that. And that could happen with the land, the way it's zoned in the future. That could happen, that this wasn't there anymore and something new was there, a strip plaza.
I do, not on that piece, because that's been deeded to the House of Hope, so it's in a 501(c)(3), it can never be given over to anything else. It could only be for a 501(c)(3) bylaw. If I die, or something happened, and House of Hope had to close, it would have to go to another nonprofit organization. So we'll never be a commercial.
Goodwill.
Well, I don't think the goodwill would go out there, but.
I'm saying, it's the land, it's about the land, it's not about the use of the land. It's about what could happen at that land.
Actually, I think it's about the land and the use. And I think there will be future development there, and I believe that the way it reads, my understanding is the way that it reads concerning that whole property out there is that if anybody wants future development out there, that they have to bring in. That is kind of what we're talking about. So we're not talking about doing a big commercial venture, we're just trying to take care of some women and children. That's the truth, Gretchen. You know me, I'm gonna be for the hard work.
Yeah, yeah, we know each other, I don't have any argument with what it is.
I mean, I think we've proved that we're honest and have integrity and we're not there.
Nobody's questioning that at all, and not one bit.
So that's our plan for use, we have no ulterior motives except to help people. That's our motive, that's our heart.
That, nobody's questioning that either.
So.
Any other questions? Thank you. Would anybody else like to speak in support of this case? Anybody like to speak in opposition to this case? No? Ms. Deborah, was your office contacted about this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Would anybody like to make a motion?
If we make the motion to approve the request, can we condition it that it, I mean, would it already be conditioned on just this particular parcel having the ability to access the property through that easement? Would that already be included in what they've asked for? Or would we need to specifically state that we want to make a motion to approve the variance request as presented, conditioned upon only this House of Hope or Village of Hope development having the ability to access off of that road? So essentially, you put a limitation on these other surrounding parcels that, you know, if they wanted to come in and do something different, some different kind of development, that that would have to be considered at another time.
I do know, like, there's the weight compound in the back that uses that even as well, on the flywheel. So there are other uses and belts that are there now that use that even. So I just wanted to be aware of that.
Yeah, I see that. Well, anything currently using it. And then additionally, this one. That way, if you wanted to come in and put a mall on somewhere back there, then you'd have to meet whatever the requirements are, our county requirements for that road. Is that even necessary? Some sort of condition like that?
We have put conditions on things before tied to the use of the property. And tied to as long as that use is on that property, correct? So you could tie it to that. I don't know that you could. I don't know how you could enforce other people not being able to use that easement road.
No, I'm just talking about if there was another development on the property, which that easement is crossing. Well, I mean, I might not even need to worry about this because, I mean, if somebody wanted to come in and develop another piece of property which this easement goes across, wouldn't they have to do the same thing that Village of Hope is doing right now?
They would have to file for another variance application, which would be tied to that easement itself. So we would hear that as a separate case.
Well, then I think what I'm proposing is really necessary.
Okay.
So, you know, would that be understood now? I'm just going to make a motion to approve the variance as requested, citing criteria T.
Okay. Do we have a second?
Second. Second.
I'm going to make a motion to approve the variance as requested, citing criteria D.
And I believe we had a second from Mr. Strickland. All those in favor? We have three in favor. All those against? Two against. Motion passes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
again for the record, this is application VAR 2019-12. This application was submitted to the zoning office by SSMT Holdings. I believe we have Mr. Trevor Shaw as a representative for this application. And here we have the same request as what you all just previously gave consideration to. This organization has a single family dwelling currently on 4173 Springbrook Drive in North Lake Subdivision. This is a planned development. The applicant is proposing to subdivide this parcel into two individual lots. In doing so, these lots will be larger than the existing lots within the North Lake Subdivision. The backside of this property is located on another local road entitled Dockside Drive, I believe it is. And I believe that there's a 60-foot easement on the Dockside Street. But there's a drainage easement there. And a lot of that vegetation that you see there, it sits somewhat in a swampy area, but that's the drainage ditch over on the dock side of this property. The photo that I have before you now is on the Springbrook side. That is the existing dwelling that you may see the tip of the roof on and the opening space on my left-hand side. I believe it is his intent to pretty much, there's 40 feet on this Springbrook side. I believe it is his intent to divide that evenly between the two lots so they'll both have roughly 20-something feet of frontage of Springbrook. According to the applicant, his daughter currently lives on this property. It is his intent to build a second single-family dwelling for his parents within a matter of months if this variance is approved for him to do so.
I have a question, Jeff.
Yes, ma'am.
We have given a lot of variances in this neighborhood because the developer made these lots basically unbuildable. A variety of building challenges. This, the building challenge of this is that the place where it has road frontage has a drainage easement and a swamp. So that's clearly the developer, when they were making this lot, were making nonsense, basically. So this lot that's there, and this is a planned development, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So that's why the lots can be narrow, like this 40 feet of frontage on this street, because there, it's a PD.
Well, to be honest with you, what I can recall about this project, Ms. Franklin, I believe this was a lot that was never deemed to be built upon. But as you can see, there is buildable land area there. But I think when this project initiated, more so that swampy drainage ditch in the back, I think it is pretty much will probably never be good
enough. Okay, well, so I end up having the same sort of conversation in my head. This fellow's going to have his daughter and his parents, or him and his parents, or him and his daughter.
Yes, sir.
But far along the road, strangers are going to be living side by side, 20 feet from each other. So the setbacks on all of these
would be
they meet the standard for the setbacks?
I did not have any wording in this application say that they would have an issue with the setbacks.
Okay, so this lot number 57, the existing house,
yes,
when they divide this in half, will meet the setback on this side?
I'm sure that it will, because he's aware that it has to, and like I said, know the side yards are not, I don't want to call it because I'm speculating, and I just can't remember.
Okay, thank you.
Any more questions for staff? Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Would the applicant or the applicant's representation like to address the board?
I'm Chuck Shaw. This is my father. I'd like to go just a little bit better view of the existing house, and then if you want to go down to the edge of the fence, the back, I'll just show you the size of the lot. The current setbacks against the side are 8 feet by 9 feet, so there's going to be a lot more than what's currently out there. I guess this is the other entrance of the 60 foot that was one of there is water and there's drainage pipeline. So this land has sat there for a long time, and there was even talks about, I guess, Carmel's at the time, they were talking about doing duplexes in there because it was enough room. So from, I wish I'll just go back in there and feel how big this feels when you get back in there, but this is in no way encroaching on any other neighbors. In fact, even when you get back there to where this existing house is, there's plenty of room to get off of that a lot farther than what the existing requirements are for perhaps the other sector. So when you get in there, there's plenty of room to get back there. The issue is only getting the variance to be able to get back there too. When I built this house, I had to run my own power back there and my own tap that was not designed for this particular lot. So I spent a good bit of money to build this house deep back and then have to run utilities up there to the front. And when I did that though, I worked with Georgia Power and they're going to set a transformer back from this back corner here for the purpose of putting another home there. And I'd already just went through, you know, talking to Mike and Severin about the possibility of doing this before I started. But I'm basically just asking now, somebody will be living there. I love a home somebody didn't, but right now my parents are 78, 75, and they need to get closer to somebody in the family, and so that's why we are pursuing this at this time.
So the proposed spot for the house, and I went out there and looked at it, is right in this area?
Well, actually, if you look this way, I'm standing about right here at the driveway and looking back. So what you do is tucked into that area here.
And that is the backyard kind of this house.
No, it's the backyard. When you go here,
it's all the
Because I went to the donkey side, and then I came over here and looked at
it's okay. Here, it's behind this
yes.
house.
So you see how it tucks in here? And this, okay. this is the it's really like a barrier right there. Okay. It's actually the change. So what I would do is just come back here and probably angle it like this a little bit. But that would be the backyard here for this home.
And you will actually be reworking this drive and doing away with that fence. And it would start out
as a people that have traveled through that lot for the last 10 years until I built this house, and we finally had to put up a fancy gate because people were still going back and forth from there. So that was just kind of people out. We would still do something very nice like that when it's through to make that look nice up front.
So are you planning on having a shared driveway, or are you planning on adding a second driveway?
I built that one on the side there to build another one on the side.
That's what I'm saying. You're going to have actually, when it comes off the road, probably won't have one concrete date.
Yeah, but
and then it gets split and go up in there.
Yes, sir.
I'm not sure you've got enough room to put two concrete aprons up in there.
No, I think that would, because when that deck split. There actually is room, that's 10-foot drive, a driveway there, I think we got 40 foot there. So there is room to actually do another one, but it would be, I don't think necessary.
All right, any other questions for the applicant? Mikey? I'm assuming there's nobody else here in support of the case and nobody here in opposition. Ms. Deborah, was your office contacted?
No, sir.
Okay. Are there any other questions? No? Anybody care to make a motion?
I make a motion to approve the variance citing criteria A, B, and H.
Okay.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor? 3, 4. All, oh, okay. 5. All those, oh, I'm sorry.
Did you count me?
I couldn't see. Okay. So everybody was in favor.
Yes. Is that right, Chairman?
Yes. Yes. So, unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, we will move on to other business. I believe for the last meeting, we talked about adding under other business attendance record each time.
I'm sorry, I missed that.
No, that's fine. It's fine.
I missed that, but I can hand that to the next agenda.
Okay. I believe everybody's here, but John, was did he give an excuse for not being here? Or was
I called him yesterday afternoon, and he said he was going to be here, and I've not heard anything since.
Okay. I believe, based on past...
That's unexcused.
Yeah, that's an unexcused... Okay.
But I will add the next message.
Okay, thank you. Meeting minutes. Everybody has a copy of the meeting minutes. Anybody see any changes or corrections that are needed? Anybody care to make a motion to approve the minutes?
I move the approval of the minutes as presented.
We have a second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Passes unanimously. All right. Item 5, nomination of chairman and vice chairman. I believe it's that time of year again.
I make a motion that we keep this current chairman and vice chairman.
A second. Third.
Okay. Would anybody, I don't remember, do we approve that and then go all the other nominations, or do we?
Well, you need to, I will make a motion, addition to that, the nomination to be closed.
Correct. Thank you. So we have, I guess, a chairman and a vice chairman recommended, only one, and a motion that it's closed. I think you seconded, correct? All those in favor? It is unanimous. So I believe next time we move to a vote on that, correct?
Correct.
So.
And next time we can put the 2020 calendar on the agenda for consideration. That's okay.
Yes. All right. Does anybody else have any other business they wish to bring up?
I do. So in regards regards to what I brought up last month about the county reports, it states, a variance may be granted upon the finding by the ZBA that all of the following conditions have been met. And that just completely threw me for a loop. I was so confused in reading that. Because, like we talked about last time, that's the requirement for the city. Mm-hmm. But it is not for the county. The ULDC in section 9.02.03, requirements for variance, states, a variance may be granted upon a finding by the ZBA that one of the following conditions has been met. Can we change the report to correctly state that section 9.02.03 in the future?
It used to say that, Nathan, so somewhere along the way that word one changed into the word all.
Well, it got me last month. I mean, I was sitting there staring at it the whole time we were talking.
So, Deborah? Yes. On these, can we have that corrected so that it doesn't say all of the following, but it says one of the following, please?
May I say exactly?
Yes.
I got it.
You're going to that.
That's what it says. That's what we have to see.
Oh, yes. Yes.
And all of you said.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it is the same.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
No.
Okay. Usually,
one
or more would be enough to have city or county.
Okay.
Right.
The city, when they created ULDC, the city had their size and county had their size. Then the county said, okay, we will have one or more of these. As long as they keep one or more of these.
And it's the city ones.
The city all got the right.
Okay.
You got the
discuss? No? All right. I believe we are adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you. Tracy, do you need to do anything?
You know, some of y'all didn't get to check shirt much. You got straight, you got polka dots, you all just wrote that.
Hey, we only got two options.
White and blue.
Yeah.
Y'all look better than we do.
A lot better than we do.